Craig Harrison. And joining me on the AD couch today, New Zealand heptathlete and Olympic high jumper, and awesome Kiwi girl, Sarah Cowley. Welcome, Sarah.
Thanks, Craig.
Thanks for being here.
Pleasure. Thanks for having me.
I'm going to jump straight into things, Sarah. Now, you've competed for New Zealand at both the Olympics and Commonwealth Games as a heptathlete, and more recently in the high jump. When did you decide that making the Olympics was the big dream?
Well, I think for me, I clearly remember when I was 8 years old watching the Barcelona Olympics in 1992. And so for me, it was sort of that's when the seed was first sown, I guess. And I remember watching the track and field and just being captivated by the speed of the athletes, the high jumpers, the long jumpers. I wanted to watch it all, and it was probably in the middle of the night, and so it was probably a highlights reel that I was watching. But I remember thinking, that's what I want to do. And I had to wait 4 years for the Olympics to come on again. So I had to wait a lot longer sure. before I went, yeah. but it was certainly well worth it in the end.
All right. So that's pretty early on. As a young athlete, 12 years old, 8 years old, that's so really early on to put a big dream out there on the table, isn't it?
Sure. Yeah, completely. And I think it was, I guess, a pipe dream at that sure. stage. And 12 years old, probably still a pipe dream. I mean, at that stage, kids are just so awesome and yeah. pure. I want to be an astronaut. Well, who says you can't, you know? And I think that because I didn't have those boundaries or the environment where I was like, no, you can't do that, it was completely a possible idea to me. And it's not like I had any Olympians in the family or knew of any Olympians. It was just for me at a young age, and I saw images that resonated with me, and I was like, yep, that's it.
Cool. Very cool. Growing up, were you great at just track and field, or were you just awesome at anything you did in terms of sport?
Oh, pretty much awesome at everything. Yeah. No. I would say, like, I was like a typical Kiwi kid. I did lots of different sports. So my other, like, we traditionally played like a winter code and a summer code. And I'm not sure if really that still exists in New Zealand today, but I was netball winter and then athletics summer. And I did other things like cross country, played tennis, played golf, did ballet when I was younger. Cool. And I think all those things, I certainly wasn't good at ballet, not the most twinkle toes fairy. But yeah, I mean, I generally was coordinated and a sporty kid. So awesome at some things and worked so hard to be awesome at the others and had a go.
Do you think it's important to do lots of sports growing up?
Yeah, I actually personally feel it really is, because you're developing skills and pathways that are sort of, you know, transferable to lots of different sports, whatever sporting career you take, if that's the pathway you want to take. And so for me, I encourage kids to do as much as possible, you know, change direction, run in straight lines, be able to catch, be able to throw, be able to jump. These are all fundamental skills which right. I feel are involved in lots of different sports.
Sure. So those fundamental sports are going to be applicable to whether you are jumping over a bar or running as fast as you can, changing yep. direction, throwing a rugby ball,
yep.
whatever the case
yep,
may be.
Yep, maybe.
Awesome. So what age did you think, wow, I'm pretty darn good at this track and field gig? I think I might really focus in on that one.
I think it was really when I was playing netball at high school to like a regional representative level. And then when I started to make athletics like national teams when I was 16, I sort of was at a bit of a crossroads, I guess. And I guess I wasn't enjoying the team sport as much because I was in a situation where I thought I was playing well and we were losing all the time. And so I guess the control freak in me wanted more ownership of my sure. performance. And so naturally gravitated to athletics, which I guess is now, I believe, is a team sport and that my individual team exists as that kind of right. unit. But yeah, it was really sort of towards the last couple of years of my high school that I was like, right.
And did you see a clear pathway for your track and field, or was it just sort of, I'm going to take each day as it comes and hopefully it'll lead to my dream of making the Olympics one day?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it was a long-term goal. And I mean, at 16 and 17, I mean, you think you really know it all, but you don't. Sure. 18 still, 22 still, 24 still, 30 maybe still. But I think that I guess I had the end result, and because I was, you know, naturally progressing in terms of, okay, make an age group team, then make the next age group team, so forth, that I just assumed that it would just happen. And, you know, that wasn't my journey. I had to, you know, I've had many ups and downs throughout my career so far, that I guess that if I could go back and say, could I plan that better? Absolutely.
Right. And do you think there could have been anybody that may have been able to make that journey easier for you?
I mean, I'd like to think so. And I think that the team that I have right now, they would be able to help me.
Sure.
Because I think that they certainly understand athletics, high performance sport, and just generally what it takes to be successful as an athlete. And also, I guess it's more than just the okay, this is what I want to do to go to the Olympics, training-wise. It's everything outside of that in terms of an athlete lifestyle, that these are things that you kind of wish you knew about earlier, but you have to sort of, I guess, experience them yourself.
Right, so you would have made lots of mistakes in your journey, and what do you think is the most important thing when you do make a mistake? To make sure that you're moving forward in the right direction.
Yeah, I think just learn from it. I mean, it's really cliched, but every opportunity is an opportunity to learn. And, you know, whether you do something good in training, competition, life, whatever, that's also a learning experience as well. And so I think that the mistakes, I've now reversed it to think, well, I'm actually going to learn more out of this than, instead of sitting back and just, you know, dropping my lip, because that's not going to work. And fortunately for me, I had two brothers. I grew up in a competitive family. Sport was, I guess, important, and so was a balance. But what was more important, I guess, was that we behaved in the right way. And I think that's a contributing factor to an athlete pathway.
Right, so being a good person is really important, just as much as what sort of athlete you are.
I personally would like, I personally like to think that, and I think that you know, your integrity is important. Just, you know, you're a person at the end of the day, and an athlete as well.
Sarah, I'd like to touch on commitment and dedication. Tell me about what it really took throughout your journey to make it.
Well, I think first and foremost is that it's not it's not an easy path. If it was easy, everyone would be doing
sure.
it. And the reality is, there's very few people that have the opportunity that I've had to that I've been fortunate enough to have to live my dream through sport. What did it take? Years and years and years of hard work, you know, persistence, patience, dedication to a dream when sometimes it wasn't going well. And you know, these, I think through my Olympic campaign in particular, you know, there were some of the best and worst times of my life, because sport is just, it is a roller coaster of emotions. But if you can stay on the ride, then it's so worthwhile. And I think you know, for me at high school, I was, you know, even very sort of dedicated towards my sport. I wouldn't miss training. I would do extra things. I would, you know, do things like, you know, the recovery management, the nutrition. People often ask me how many hours a week do I train?
Mm.
And I would be able to say, you know, a rough fixed number depending on the where I am in my program. But then they don't realise that outside of that, I would do maybe half of those hours, say, if I train 20 to 25 hours a week, let's say, and then I would do 10 to 15 hours of recovery work, rehab work, so Pilates, yoga, physio, all my medical management. And then on top of that is you're, as an athlete, you have a lifestyle which, you know, is not 9 to 5.
24/7,
I think. 24/7. Yeah. And, you know, I'm lucky to have had this. But it's just, you know, when you're sleeping, that's part of it. Because you're recovering and sleep is so important for athletes. You know, you should be having, you know, what they're recommending is 60 to 70 hours of sleep a week for athletes. And so, you know, every minute of the day is part of the big picture. And so what it takes is a level of commitment that only some people can really subscribe to. But for me, there were times when I questioned, what am I doing? You know, some of my friends are out buying houses, having real jobs. And but, you know, in the times that I achieved what I wanted to do, those sweet moments that money really can't buy, that's just like, I'd do it all again.
Right. And I recently heard that life is about those moments that you speak of, and no doubt being an Olympic athlete would have had plenty of downs, but plenty of great moments as well.
Oh, completely. Like, I mean, I wouldn't trade this for anything. And the experiences that I've had as an athlete have been, you know, afforded me opportunities that I would have never had imagined. And the Olympics is, I can say I'm an Olympian.
Absolutely.
And, you know, no one can take that away from me. And it's something that I'm proud of because, you know, I was an Olympian when I was 28. So 8 years old, I started to dream about this. And 20 years later, it came true. And even when I, you know, say that and I talk to school groups and things like that, I still get a little bit emotional about it because it's like, so it required so much work. And it wasn't just about me as well. It was about, you know, my friends, my family, and my team and all those people that had collectively been behind me. And because I guess that not many people get to experience that, I felt like it was my role to experience it for them as well.
Right.
Yeah, that makes sense.
No, it definitely does. It's very cool. So on this note, really, we talk about sacrifices and not doing things that perhaps your friends are, or, you know, perhaps going to the beach during summer. Tell me about the big sacrifices that you had to make, not only in recent years on your Olympic campaign, but also growing up at school.
Yeah.
You know, those earlier years in your training.
Sure. Well, first of all, I think it's really important to say that it's not really a sacrifice, it's a choice. And I think that you've got to be really clear about that, because you're choosing this way of living because you're choosing the end goal, whatever it may be, Olympics, World Cup, whatever. So for me, the biggest choices, I guess, that I made were, you know, the high school parties.
Yeah.
Dial a sober driver, me.
Yeah.
And I guess nutrition stuff. And that flowed on to university. O-week I was training, you know, and because I was so focused on what I wanted to do that my friends just accepted it. And I soon found out who was not prepared to accept it, or kind of, you know, judged me, or, I mean, you know, were not as supportive as other people. And so I naturally gravitated towards these people.
Right.
But so I also made a choice to come to Auckland to train at AUT Millennium, and as opposed to going to any other university, because of I thought this would be the right balance in terms of lifestyle, in terms of training environment, and it's worked out well. It's my second home. I've been here from the start. And I also think that it's about, I mentioned sleep before, it's about early nights, it's about being around the right people, it's about essentially being a little, well, selfish in terms of what you want to get to. And, you know, that's all right. That's actually all right if that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
You know, still keep your integrity, but if you're on a mission, you're on a mission.
throughout the journey, there were a lot of people giving you advice. You know, this bright star, up-and-coming athlete throwing their two cents in. How did you know who
they
to listen to?
They still are. People will always be telling you what to do. They'll think they'll have the right, you know, I've got this thing to show you. It's going to make the difference.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be doing that. You should be doing this. I mean, I was at a gym recently and I was with the head of strength and conditioning of New Zealand, and this guy walked up to us and told us how to, you know, squat jump properly. And so that never stops. And it's, yeah, it's certainly for me as a younger athlete in a developmental kind of stage, it's really difficult because, you know, I like to please people. Unfortunately, it's tiring. But so because of that, I want to listen to people's advice. And I think you always want to listen to people, but then you want to really be selective about who you truly listen to and what's that advice going to do for you in terms of where you're going to go in the end. And it's difficult to say no to someone. So you need to develop strategies around that. And I think that for me, it was people were telling me which event to go to.
Right.
Which event within athletics. So, and they were also telling me which sport to play. And they're still trying to tell me that.
What are you going to try next year?
I can't tell you right now, Craig. But it's just about surrounding yourself, having people that you can go to that you trust.
Yeah.
And that you value their opinion. And that trust has to be a two-way relationship. You know, they have to trust you as well with the advice that they're going to give you.
Awesome. Well, on that note, Sarah, the way we finish all our sessions on the couch here at AD is one piece of advice that you can give every young athlete there, up and coming, looking at whether it's making it to the top or just enjoying their time in sport. What sort of advice could you give to those athletes?
I would say that as a young athlete, it's so important to love what you do. Because, like I say, it's a long journey, and whatever your journey ends up to be, you're going to apply a lot of hours, a lot of your time. Your parents are going to be running you around. So you've got to make sure that, you know, this is what you want to do and that you love what you want to do. And just have fun. Get out there and enjoy it.
Yeah, having heaps of fun. Great advice. I'd just like to thank you for coming on the couch today. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on. That's it for now on the AD Couch. Join us next time for our next special guest. Bye for now.